it's not unexpected, like your slogan, that definitely school management will definitely come up with some policies that students will normally want to resist. How many of such happened the time you were president, and how did you handle them?
We had many anti-student policies. Remember, we were living in the time of the military. It was during our bachelor's time. And Lagos State University was the most militant in the whole of Nigeria. And I repeat, the most militant. Yes, Ife was there. Yes, you know, like ABU was there. But LASU was militant, more militant, in the sense that we had vehicles. We could move at will. Other schools, their vehicles were controlled by their management. I remember one of those situations where Showore came, Showore was former president of UNILAG, came to campus to meet me, that he had a protest and he wanted me to support. He had already gone to Oceanography, Yaba Tech, they didn't give their support. And I was controlling my vehicles. I had two 1414 buses. I had a coaster, I had one Bedford, I had two coasters, and all of that under my control. And I said, okay, I'll support you. Even some activists on campus, they want to follow Showore. Like, don't worry, I'll go with you. We were to commemorate the death of Kesaro Wiwa then. So I mobilized students, I took Showore. We went to Broad Street, Shell was having their office then at Mama Kantagora House. That was where Shell office was. Then we came out with a mascot symbolizing Kesaro Wiwa being hung. Then we were there crying, carrying our posters, there were pressmen on the ground, area boys that joined us. Suddenly Operation Sweep, that was the code they used, Operation Sweep, just arrived. And that would have been a massacre. Because what we heard then was that there was a directive from Asuro that we should be shot. Then it was Abubakar Saab, the then commissioner of police, that God used in saving us. If I'm right about his name, I think it was Abubakar Saab. Then he just suddenly appeared from nowhere. Showore, well, we have stopped now. What again? Then Showore said, no, that we must carry out the protest. A protest that has so many crowd. Suddenly were less than 20 people that were there. And if we had been shot on that day, it would have been the end, because they had cocked their guns and just waiting for an order. Then he spoke with Sav and all that. He came back, we addressed the press, and we went. They went to our car and returned back. I remember the school authority then went to increase GNS textbook from 1,005 to 7,000 naira, and they only wanted me to say okay, and they were promising to give me 1,000 naira per textbook. And I said no, that we will not pay that. Even the 1,005 we're paying for us was too expensive. They also came again that we should pay acceptance fee of 10,000 naira. That is for the incoming students. And I said no again, that why must I pay acceptance fee to who? They have written JAMB, they have passed JAMB, they have passed their WAEC, so acceptance fee to who? And they have passed, they have paid school fees, paid their medical fee, and so many fees, so we refused. They came again that we needed to pay some money for furniture, we refused. That the fee we were paying is enough, and education must be free. That was our policy. I remember, I will show you some pictures too, when the World Bank, IMF, also came wanting to borrow Nigerian money. I remember I also led some struggle with Larry Legacy. Went to Ife, the Amphi. I spoke at the amphitheater, addressed the Ife student with Dr. Dipo Fashino, who was then ASU National President, and we're going from state to state, and all of that. Even when they increased the pump price of fuel, I remember I was on the street protesting. Then This man that is heading police affairs now was the commissioner of police. Then Okiru. That was the first time I slept in detention. I've never been caught. And I had to surrender myself because of my friend, my bosom friend, Chichino. Chichino was from Unilag. He was not a bank manager. He was from Unilag. We had met, we had congregated at the Tai Shulani Square, Yaba. We were much in our thousands. I remember I had malaria. And Obasanjo had sent Mr. Mao, who was the director of NSS in Lagos State then, with a ticket, a flight ticket for me to meet him in Abuja, in Aso Rock. I told Mao then that you guys want to arrest me, and I won't follow you. If you can give me a 14-14 bus, I will get to Aso Rock before the following morning, 7 a.m. And he said, do I want them to sack him? I said, how? He said the instruction was that he should come with me. I said, I won't go. By then I was PR of Nance. I said, I won't go. And all of that. So the following morning we led out the protests. We came to Yaba. They had condoned off the Ojuelegba angle, condoned off the Yaba angle, started shooting tear gas. And they dropped the tear gas in my leg. This leg would have gone. There was a comrade from Unila called Kosishuru. Sheriff picked the tear gas. As I was about throwing the tear gas away, the thing cut off his hand. But we had this courage that if we keep quiet, the police would think they have intimidated us. So we started singing. They told us to shut up. We refused. We had trust in the cell. Thank God for Ashwaju. I heard the discourse with Okiru and the security people that, look, you have to take away these two leaders from the cell because Lagos was boiling, what was charged. The students were ready to bring down the government. And the resistance was led by Burkina. Burkina Mayo, who later became the president of IFE, was leading that resistance. But I told them, like, they kill us, you guys should continue. And all of that. Adam Oshiomhole was president of Labour NLC. Then later the police came same day to release us. In fact, the prisoners wanted to beat us inside there. Immediately they threw us in like their normal ritual. But we addressed them that we were Nigerian students that were fighting outside to bring out the pump price of fuel and all that. And they showed us one of their colleagues that was shot and the leg was full of muco. I was saying we're going to tell Amnesty International and the CLO. So they kept us very close to the gate, the VIP section, gave us water and all of that. Several hours later we were released and we were taken to Ashwaju and they told us that look, you have been trying to discuss with the president that the increment was senseless and all of that. Then Okiru came in to apologize and I told Ashwaju I won't listen to this man. I was about walking out before Burkina held me. That this was a man that locked us and all of that. So he apologized that he has a duty to perform and all of that. And we told him that look, we were fighting for not just the country, also you. We were going to pull off this uniform one day. We are fighting for better educational reform because your children too will go to the university. How much is your salary? If the country is better, it would be better for all members of the Nigerian police, the army, and every Nigerian. And the country become better. Our fight is not for ourselves, but it's for the country. And so there were many policies that we fought for or fought against that even nearly cost us expulsion, even in Lasu. I remember I was expelled for 1 week once, alongside with every member of the parliament, and we were reinstated that very same week. But we refused to cool off. And it was every day of tear gas. We'll come back, continue the fight. The second day we'll come back, the third day we'll come back. Like that. Even GC98. That was another struggle that made me face four panels. I faced the panel of governing council, I faced the black panel of the school, faced the House of Assembly panel, and I faced Ashwaju's panel, headed by him. And in that panel, all of the panel was exonerated because the school had admitted more than they can chew in that year. And they were now coming up that the students should just go home and go and sit for JAMB again. And they admit JAMB for that same year again. So it means they will sit home for 2 years. I said, how logical is it? Their parents came from matric with members of their family, and you're now saying they should go back home to go and sit for JAMB again after they've missed that 1 year JAMB. In fact, one of the students I heard, my name is Confirm, committed suicide. We refused. Finally, we got our lawyer, Barrister Shino Ogunlanu. We call him Sherubami. Sherubawo. We went to court, got an interlocutory injunction from Justice Kekereekun that the students be allowed to stay on campus while the case continued. Even when I graduated, I still came to the witness box to defend the student. At the end of the day, we won the case. But history repeated itself again. 2 years after that incident, the same thing happened again. But this time around, Lasso had learned from the past. They now deferred the admission, which was what we were canvassing for.
You mentioned Lasso, and incidentally, it happens to be where you came from. Currently, Lasso is seeming to be another center where there is also controversy about sudden jack-up in tuition, which is being protested even till now. What is your attitude to the increase in tuition in Lasso? You're also a member of the government in this state right now. What was the contribution then, and what is the state of affairs? As come to stay, is there something that could be done? Would you encourage students to protest that now?
Frank Fanon said, every generation out of his own relative obscurity determines its mission, either to fulfill it or betray it. The process in which Chief Wakan Awolo Nnamdi Azikiwe, Chief Enahoro Anthony, CFR, and many of them using the Nigerian student movement to fight for independence, including this activist from Ghana, the Kwame Nkrumah. You know, they all met in the student movement, they formed a student movement in UK, and they used that to start fighting for independence. The mode of independence, fight for independence, differed. Now, post-independence after 1960, a lot of African countries between 1960 and 1965 got independence. Those who couldn't get it after 65, downturn 80s, went through a militant voyage that was very drastic, very violent, and all of that. Now, student leaders that were also fighting for other causes, the Anglo Defense Pact of 1962, led by Tunji Otagbaya and the rest, also used some certain media. The Ali Mongo, one of the most bloody revolutionary struggle that students fought in Nigeria, including the China Student Revolt of 1981, and so many other revolts like that, also have different phases. SAP riot of 1989 and 1991 also came in their own shades, and all of that. Likewise, our own struggle. I will not determine how the student will fight their fight in a democratic setting. But they will not fight the way we fought in the military setting. In the military setting, they have thrown sensibility, the rule of law, they've thrown it out. In a democratic setting, students have different means of fighting their cause. One, a non-violence approach, very peaceful approach, civil disobedience. They can also go to court to push that point. But the point I'm telling you now is, one, look at the scenario that is playing off in Lagos State. Lagos has a lot of challenges on its shoulders, both infrastructure and what have you. Lagos has funds that are not able to cope with these contemporary challenges. That is not to say that the government of Lagos State cannot make education free. But when you look at these challenges, one roads, another infrastructure, infrastructural challenges and all of that, what Lagos has tend to do is to create a roadmap, which I've also discussed both in corridor and in the open. And the logical conclusion is that we must take a path that looks so painful now for us to have a very joyous future at the time comes. I can assure you that in the nearest future to come, Lagos will give free and qualitative and quantitative education not to only Lagosians but to all Nigerians. But as of now, it's just like in some higher climes, when you have economic recession, you see some people that will advocate that, look, let us impose higher taxes. Higher taxes is going to be very, very punitive, it will cause a lot of pain, but we will cross the Rubicon. And when we cross the Rubicon, you bring down the tax measure. Let's look at it as a process in which we just have to collectively endure. It is like I quoted from Fanon from the first time. People will ask that, if it has happened in your time, would you not have been deprived of going to school? Yes, perhaps. Yes, perhaps. But even in my own time, did I get the right qualitative education that I needed? Did my generation get it? An education that would prepare us for the greater challenges. An education that will liberate us from us not tying ourselves to the apron of government to provide jobs for us. An education that can make us self-subservient and not be looking at blue-collar jobs or somebody to employ us, but rather we become employer of labor. I will not say more than that, but I can assure you that in the future time to come,
prices of
education will be free. In the future time to come,
when that future
very, 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 very soon. And that is why in the APC, we are fighting so strongly to make sure that we win the center. And we are still agitating for a sovereign national conference. If we convoke a sovereign national conference and a people's constitution, people's driven, is made, produced by the people, to the extent that states, local government get enough resources to build government from bottom to top, the issue of school fees will become nullity. Because the school itself will be fully democratic. The school itself, through research and what have you, can make more funds. The state will see education as a mandamus to the extent that it's well funded, to the extent that the funding stream will not be altercated by any other need from any other corner. Because as it is right now, Lagos is contending to providing enough roads, contending to providing health care qualitative for its citizenry. Lagos is funding the Nigerian police to the extent that it's providing ammunition, to the extent that it's providing uniforms, operational vehicles, and so many things. And all of these things are sinking funds. You can imagine the money that Lagos is investing alone in Nigerian police and is taking it to the academia. You can imagine how the pressure will come down. You can imagine the money that Lagos is investing into federal infrastructure. Like I have been in First Tech Town. I just came today from the Public Works Bureau. To fix four roads, I'm going to spend $121 million. If I take that money to the primary school, you will see a lot of smiles in the face of the children. That is what is contending with fun. But like I said, it is a passage that we must train to pass. I can only encourage the generation that is bearing it I know how it is. I know the pain. I know how much I give out as financial support. It's a very painful process. But I can only encourage the generation that is going through it that in the shortest time possible, it will become things of the past. And they also, that the children of Israel that passed through Egypt, we have story to tell. That they went through all of this for a better tomorrow for a lot of people.
So let me take you back, because it seems we're already entering politics, because you've now been talking about your own activities as chairman of and what you have been going through. But let me take you a little back. You trying to encourage students that they should take it easy, try to comport themselves, it's a matter of time. If, let's assume this is a time that you were president of students in Lasu, and price of education jacked up to 250,000 from 25,000, would you have listened to somebody say this to you from the government? How would you have reacted?
We had a slogan on campus. It was militant but reasonable. Every generation, out of its own relative obscurity, determines its mission. I will not determine how the student will fight their fight.